You can go ahead and start, Barret.
Awesome. Thanks, Glenn. Yeah, that was a good night. And it was really nice, JJ, to give me that opportunity. Okay, share screen. Let's see how this works. And before we get too far, I'll have the chat up. Also, if you guys can keep your cameras on as much as you feel comfortable, I can see your pretty faces and nods, which helped me out because we can, thank you, Todd, because I can make this talk 5 minutes or, 2 hours, depending on the blank stares. And I'd prefer to make it happy to you guys because we have a small group. So font size seems good there. How is font size over here? We can read that. Okay, thumbs up all around. Awesome. Cool. All right. Well, whoever designed this wonderful pamphlet handout, thank you so much. It was great. So I stole it for my title slide. So again, my name is Barret Schloerke. You can find me on Twitter and GitHub at Schloerke. I kind of post about relatively not too exciting things, but super exciting things to me. And kind of infrequent. Let me move my Zoom bar here. Great. Yeah, and as I said, I'm at our studio and I've been there just over 3 years now. So it's been lots of fun. All right, gonna kind of go through Plumber and set the stage up with a data set that we all can find and use on our own personal machines and kind of go over what's an API and then how Plumber is an API and possibly some new Plumber features along the way. And finally, then once we have our APIs, we want to deploy them. Slash little plug for our studio, and then links to some additional resources. And I'll hand this PDF out to Harvard, and then they can distribute it some however they want later. Probably link to it within the videos. All right. So in R, I think one of your first demos that you should have, like demo data sets now, is the Plumber Penguins data set. And it's a lot of fun. It's got some gotchas in there. It has more fields than just the two columns of the cars data set. Has 300 observations, so it's a lot bigger than the 50 observations that we're used to. So that's really nice. And it's good for modeling because we can predict the species. Lots of good things can come out of this one. And it's more complicated than just like standard numerics that some other data sets. And it's fun. And Allison Horst has designed some wonderful artwork to go with data set, so it's super cutesy. And this is Harvard Data Science. So I assume you can already do the data science part. So you can fit your models, you can, calculate 1+1, things that you've already done in R, we can do that. So in this case, this code here is we're just fitting a random forest, setting the engine to, I think it's Ranger, classification for the mode, and we're going to classify the species according to all the other columns, given the penguins data set, and then we can have a model afterwards. This is using the parsnip package. You can do whatever you want. I don't care, up to you. But this is just like kind of setting the stage so that we have some familiarity of what's going on. Okay, so I fit my model and I have my model. So now what? Like, I want to show my boss, I want to show my professor, I want to show the person who pays me. I want to integrate this into pipelines. Like, what do I do? And so before we kind of get in there, let's talk about what is an API, because this will kind of set the stage on for like what Plumber does. So an API is an application protocol interface. And this is something that provides a consistent way to communicate. It's your handshake. If we look at it as a web API, web APIs are something that communicate over HTTP, and it's a standardized way for computers to communicate back and forth. So when you go to google.com, you send a request, you get some response back, and that handshake is agreed upon. You could even argue that Google.com is a web page that is part of an application programming interface, an API, because when you go there, you know you're going to get a search engine back. So that has been established, and that is the handshake between Google and you, that route, that URL. It would be very weird if you went to google.com and out came YouTube. That would be very different. That would be breaking the programming interface that you're used to. So browser, you send that request, the server responds, and making that consistent and predictable is what we're about with that. So how can we leverage this? So you've built up your model, you have it in your RMD, and you want to share it, and you're part of a company and they want to use it. Normally, like I've heard a lot of stories where someone's like, I built up my whole model over 3 months. I showed my manager. They went, cool, let's re-implement it in another language and give it to engineering. And it's like, what? Yeah, no one wants to hear that as the model developer, because most likely the little nuances will be off. And you've worked your time on it and you're the expert of that knowledge. So what if we could give the engineering team something like a web URL to say, look at my model or calculate this piece of information, and they don't need to be any wiser that it's R underneath the hood. Yeah, surrounded by Python developers. Exactly. So now with Plumber, what we can do is expose your model via a web API called Plumber, and then we can use that to connect to JavaScript or to C# or to Python. And they can just do their normal web request, like they're saying, download google.com, and everything like will be as expected, and they won't know that it's R underneath the hood. Little side story. Miss Nolis is at T-Mobile, and T-Mobile actually, when you send your first text to the help desk, that first when they ask you a couple questions and how your response, that response actually is hitting a Plumber API underneath the hood, and that's handling thousands and thousands of requests. No one knows, right? But they can hook up in the framework and in the engine, so that as it comes along, then it's routed into a web route, and then this response is handed off. And that middle part was processed using R, because R's modeling and everything else is really good. No need to re-implement that. So it scales to big companies. It's not something that's like, we can't do this. So it's very exciting. There we go. That's right. Cool. All right, so Plumber, let's take a look at how we can make this Plumber API. So Plumber is like a standard R file, except that there's little special comments that are added into your R file. Trying to think of it, if you've ever developed an R package, it's very similar to like RocksGen comments. So looking at things like @param, here we have the @param, except the comment is not the typical like #. To avoid clashing, you can use #, or you can double dip and you can do the #. But Plumber has it, like, since it has its own special tags that RocksGen doesn't have, you can use the #. And so we can have things like the title of your function, just like with RocksGen. We can then do @param, your parameter, and then the description about that parameter. You can even insert some type definitions like colon, int to say it's a, I think you can do int, but you can insert some type definitions in there as well. And then finally, the most important part, you can define your route. And I think this is a really clean solution that you can just say like @git to make a git route, and then slash the route name. In this case, it's echo. Background on the routes. There's four main types, but two are the two most popular ones are the git and the post routes. So a git route is you go to the server and say, hey, can I have an answer, please? and then they respond back. Where a post is like, you kind of like have a package and you throw it at the server, and then they have to unpack that package before handling the route, and then they respond back. You know, it's nice when you have like more than just like a couple parameters to maybe do a post when you're requesting information, because the URL can only be so big. But a post object in your post request, a post object can be megabytes. Like it doesn't, no big deal. So you can send in like a whole book of text, not a problem. But with a URL, I think you only get like a couple thousand characters. So if it doesn't serialize too well, you might want to do a post. But for any practical purpose, they're very similar. A request is made and a response will be given back. Cool. You can also add in special tags as well, such as API title, to like describe the whole API, like the API as a whole. Not what I wanted. And then finally, we can plumb it using the Run API button in the top right corner of the RStudio IDE. We look for special tags because even though this is just a plain old R file, if like these special tags are found, then the little Run API button will appear. Cool. All right, so let's look at the Penguin API. See if I can figure this one out. Okay, cool. Neat. All right, so we have that same example. Let's echo back and a function. Function. So let's go ahead and run the API and see what happens. So RStudio will automatically plumb it. It's running it, setting it up, and then the Swagger docs on the right will automatically show up for you. And I really enjoy this about Plumber, in that we try to say, hey, I found these four routes. I know they're a git post and a git get. You gave me some descriptions. You gave me some more information, such as the API title, which is not there. No big deal. So I can kind of give you information for the Swagger implementation. Side note, Swagger uses open API specification. So if you want to get advanced and write your own and then use that instead, you can, but you know, I'll get you a quarter of the way there, or at least something usable. But one of the nice parts is you can try it out. So looking at the echo route, we're here. So given a message, then we have our regular R code, and it says it'll return an object that has the message or MSG key, and then in it, we will paste saying the message is whatever was supplied. If we try it just as is, try it out and execute, you can see the curl command that's executing underneath the hood. And then the response is, the message is quote, quote, so nothing was there, but we didn't supply anything. So let's go ahead and put a message in here and say, Barret, I can execute. You can see that it was formatted into a parameter of question mark MSG is Barret. So you can execute this in your own like terminal, or you can reformat this URL to your own language. So in Python, you could say, you know, curl this, and it would work as you expect. And it response comes back saying the message is Barret. So that was exactly the echo route. It is returning application JSON by default. This can be changed later, and we'll show that. Cool. Next one I have is the adding to numbers. This one shouldn't be too surprising, but it's a post, so I'm supplying some information. It could be a GET request because it's not that big a data, but just an example to show how the post works. So we try it out, and I can do 3 and 4. We expect 7. So there's the route that it's being posted to, and the response body is 7. So cool. No, again, not too fancy though. This is where it gets a little fun. So small example, in R, there's the hist function. So if I was to run this in the console, let me Kill it. There we go. Then command N. We say N is 100. I come up with a bunch of norms and I make a histogram. Nice. Returning a plot is not as easy as returning numbers. It's not JSON. It's binary data. So to give it more information, we can say instead of JSON, we should say your serializer is now a PNG. And that way we'll capture any images that are created inside your function.
So Barrett, can you just tell me, I mean, this looks like a base R plot.
Correct.
Right? Mm-hmm. So like, so you're setting up an API that means that all of this, like the summing is all done inside R, is that right?
Correct. The engine of your API is an R session.
Okay, right. I just wanted to get that clear in my brain. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, it's kind of fun where it's like if,
And so then the idea would be that eventually you would give people like some kind of web address and then they would be able to run your R session remotely. Is that what I'm thinking? Am I wrong thinking that or something?
It's exactly correct. So let's execute this
and
get the information. And if I take this curl request and where is my terminal? Isn't there a terminal in here? Or did I close it? I think I might have closed it.
Yeah, it looks like you closed it because I think there is one someplace, but I think you can just go up to, I don't remember the shortcut.
Open new terminal. Great, right? Haha, it worked. Okay, loading up terminal, just thinking about it. Oh, wow. All right, maybe we won't do that one. But let's say with, trying to think of a quick demo here without having terminal access. Oh, great. So in the console, if I was running my Plumber API, then I could be in the terminal and do a git request and it comes back and it says here. And from the terminal, it is no wiser that it was done by R, Python, static, HTML, doesn't matter. And I think that's super powerful. Like, curl doesn't need to know at all. And
right.
So you can have your complicated model, you can then just expose this, or you can tell engineering to just say, hey, you need to support my Plumber API. And we can do this with Docker files and other things. I'll get that to the later on today. But yeah, it's very exciting knowing you don't have to re-implement this or just hand it off blindly. Okay. All right, so histograms though. All right, I can do the same thing. We've set up a serializer PNG to let Plumber know that this route, we need to open up a PNG image catcher. We can catch any plots that are returned or printed. And then we'll close that and show what's going on. So I can try it out. Can execute with 100 random numbers. There was the curl command. And then the response body, because we know the response header is an image PNG, it will display it nice and pretty here in the response body as the image. So you know your API is working. And that's really powerful. I think it also extends out to HTML widgets. And I think we can do some other special formats as well. Not just your standard, here's JSON. One of the newer features of Plumber is this @Plumber tag. So in your R file, it's kind of hard to get access to the Plumber object directly. So if you want to make changes that are not something that's easily done, such as this, telling the route is a git, and you want to do something special, you can access the Plumber tag using the at Plumber, or sorry, you can access your Plumber router using the at Plumber tag, and then you can do whatever you want as long as you return the same Plumber object. In this case, there's a function called setDocs, and it's using the RapidDoc library. I enjoy this one just because I think it's a little bit shorter, like it's more condensed and a little more user like prettier to look at. But a lot of people are expecting Swagger, so I could not change the default. But just like, and it's less clicks to get through to an example as well. So I enjoy it.
There's some questions in chat, Barret.
I'm missing it.
I think I answered my own question by looking at the documentation, so I should be quiet. But it was about what was the serializer actually doing and how does that function, but it's translating the R to something that can be understood by the client.
Correct. There's also like, so setting up the content type. And also the important one for the images is that we do need to like open a device, execute your function, and then we need to close a device, a printing device. And that's hard compared to other ones. Whereas like we have like a feather serializer or you can make an arrow serializer. Things are not like too difficult because if you have something you're used to, like a data frame, you can turn it into a feather data frame, like with write feather or something like that. And so I think we can say like serializer feather, but it wouldn't work for the histogram, but it would work for maybe like sum or data set. Those are a little more straightforward. And I think feather does the default type of like application octet stream or something like that, or you might do application feather so that you can distinguish on the other side if you're passing from one to one to one to one. If content type is rings a bell, that's really neat. If not, don't worry about it. Let's see.
Yeah. So Nicole had another question in the chat. That's just a little above that.
Yes, Plumber is very similar to Flask. Also in Python, I believe, been told there's the 1,000 different API hosts that you can use, like Fast API, Flask, and they're all very similar. There's about a handful of those in R, and I think one of them is, one of the top ones is Plumber. There's some features in other APIs that are, I think, are a little nicer, and so I'm strongly looking at them to how I can implement them in R. Next week, we'll talk about async development within Plumber, and because R is the engine for your Plumber API. R is typically synchronous, kind of single-threaded. Only one thing can work at a time. But we have lots of cores on our machine, so I like to leverage them, and it allows for code to execute out of order or requests to execute out of order, depending on how you've set up your model or your API. So we'll get into that next week. So then to kind of tie it into the penguins, we have Plumber penguins here. I'm setting up the serializer to be YAML. So it's not JSON, it's now YAML. And just to be more data science-y, I take a number n coming in, it defaults to 20% of the penguins data. And so I can create a train data set, a test data set. I can use ParseNet to fit a model. I can then take all of the penguins that don't have NA values and try to predict, given my model, the species, given the first N rows of penguins. So let's actually try that. So I do a git. I say N is what, 45? So I should get 45 results back. I say try, doesn't like N plus one, wonderful demo. N is a non-numeric. Oh, N is a double. What was its curl command? N is 45. Huh. Well, this is fun. so let's go back here. We'll just take this off.
Because you're multiplying by, oh wait, maybe I'm wrong. Sorry, never mind.
Oh, it's all good. See if it was the API. So let's make it 45. Huh. Simple error, n plus one. None. Well, this is fun. So let's look at what our n value is. Live debugging.
This is always my favorite part. It's when it doesn't work and I get to see what people who really know how to code do.
Not that so I know, we come in, but... oh, it's quote 45. That's right. So it is quote 45 because it comes in as a character value because it's a query string. So the query string is a character from the URL. So Plumber is no wiser to tell you what it should be or should not be. So what we can do.
And you find that. I just want to tell everyone that you found that because you looked at the console, the R console, and it's quoted as 45. I see that. Yeah.
Quote 45. So we can just do a n is as dot numeric of n as a safety check. We could also then do n is like just to have fun. We could do the min of n row of penguins and n because can't say I want, you know, the first infinite amount of rows or 100,000 rows if that doesn't exist. And we could also do n is the max of n and what? One, so you must have at least one number. So at this point, I think it's pretty good. Save, great, rerun it, go into penguins, try it out, 45, execute, and I get a bunch of penguins. Sweet, punch and strap. Yeah. I would not, yeah, exactly. So this is a good example of sanitizing your inputs. Strongly recommend you do that. You can wrap things up like this into functions. So you can say like convert to number with a min and max, and then that way you don't need to re-implement like these five lines of logic over and over again. It's handy. And yes, be very, very careful about doing system calls because if you named your kid Tommy Drop Tables, you know, all the schools get very mad. So, yeah, cool. All right. That's a lot faster than I remember. Okay, so that's example with the Plumber API. So now that we have our API, let's talk about deployment because you know we need to share this, right? I can run this on my personal machine, but that you know gets shut off at 5 o'clock, so you know it's not going to work for everyone there. There's three big deployment options that are readily available. So we have RStudio Connect, we have Docker, and then DigitalOcean. So RStudio Connect. Like spoiler, I work at RStudio, but push button deployment. It has all the dependency management, so you don't need to worry about like, oh, is this package installed or are these you know system requirements installed? They'll do it, and then it scales as well. So as your API starts to get under larger request load, you know it'll spawn more R sessions to hopefully relieve that tension, that pressure. And allow your APIs to respond quickly. There's Git integration so that you can just post your API to a GitHub repo, and then RStudio Connect will pick that up, you know, within the next 15 minutes. Authentication and a whole bunch of other stuff that are really awesome about RStudio Connect. For education, You should check out the education tab within our studio. I think they have strong discounts. And then also for classes, our studio cloud is very handy because I think those instances live pretty for a long time, and there's a full static URL. So check it out. It's pretty neat. For Docker and DigitalOcean Docker, we do provide a Docker image. So you can use that as a base or as inspiration for your own image because it's fairly small. If you can deploy your own Dockers, it's probably a good way to go because you can spin them up, shut them down. You can hand them off to engineering, and you know they know how to handle Docker images typically. DigitalOcean is a great way if you want to roll your own server for like $5 a month. It's really nice, and that is a separate Plumber deploy R package. And you know, with one R function, we can deploy out and spawn a whole new DigitalOcean instance for you, and that is maintained by the user Meztez, Bruno Tremblay. Mm-hmm. So resources, if you want to take your screenshot, this is one of those good ones for a screenshot. otherwise, it'll be link. The links will work in the PDF that we'll send out later. Our Plumber.io has all of the articles, docs, examples, things like that. RStudio Plumber is the GitHub location for it. Plumber examples, we're trying to expand these out in like different, like bigger ones that maybe we don't want to send to everyone in the package, but have some specific use cases. Plumber deploy is where you can make your own DigitalOcean instance. RapidDoc is the different UI that I showed you. And then we've talked about Plumber in some other webinars and things like that at our studio. So there's some good resources and other resources as well in the RStudio webinars. And then on community, you can just post general questions like, hey, how do I, you know, type my parameter? You know, how do I do this? And that's the perfect spot under tag Plumber. A handful of people will get it, and it's pretty rapid response. So that's awesome. And then the RStudio conference, there's usually a handful of talks about Plumber, and it's exciting to see there. So here's my mind map that is partially revealed, and we'll fill in the next part on next week. But you know, you can use R, which hosts Plumber, and then we can use HDR with an R or curl, Python, Java, whatever, to make requests using HTTP. And Plumber will respond with HTTP back. Questions? Or you'll have to submit a GET request, and then I'll answer that question.
I have one question, Todd should go. Todd has a question.
No. Christian, you go first, and then I'll go.
So, you know, one of the things that comes across my mind is like the way you're advocating using it, it's like maybe pass off a Docker image to engineering or something like that. I'm kind of thinking one of the next logical steps is like, okay, I want to run multiple Plumber APIs. And so, you know, is there a recommended way to do that? Is there a way to set them up on like different routes? Maybe usually that's handled with like Docker. Maybe you have another like layer. Like I'm familiar with Nginx for, you know, my web, you know, traffic management. And so I'm kind of imagining maybe I can point like a certain subdomain to a Docker image that's running Plumber, and I can do that for a couple different subdomains. But I'm just curious, like, is that a good idea or should I do something different?
Nginx is great. I mean, it's what it's built for. So you can have, if you had one server that did all your work, you could have multiple Plumber instances running at the same time in the background session. And then Nginx could route that traffic. You could also have multiple, like separate servers so that they each get their own computing engine. And then Nginx would sit in front of that or that set of servers. So it's not just on one machine. Plumber is not built to do that outer handling, routing. It's built to just answer the URL that it received and then process it with R, not to reinvent the wheel. That's like solidly done by Nginx. Nginx can then also do the HTTPS authentication for you. And then once it's through, it could, it would strip that and hand off HTTP to Plumber. I believe, I may have that wrong, but Plumber will probably not do HTTPS because of that.
But so like a traffic would be encrypted, like getting to your server, and then like it's unencrypted in, inside the R session, but that's it, right? Like
this kind of,
Yeah,
from Nginx to Plumber is unencrypted, but I take it by that point, it's private, so.
Thank you, that totally answers my question.
And my question was pretty much about, you just answered it, was scalability. How do you deploy this? What does it look like? In, but Nginx, that answers my question, just a bunch of Dockers and it's doable. Security-wise, because in my universe, it's gonna, we're gonna wanna put this out there, so to speak, and it's gonna need to be secured. You mentioned that it does not support HTTPS. I'm assuming that's on the back end.
So Plumber, like Plumber doesn't, sits on top of the HTTPV library. Lib HTTPUV, I believe, like if you go to Linux land, it sits on top of there, and that I don't believe supports HTTPS. It won't do it.
In a production, in a fully functioning production environment that has a, you know, live, you mentioned an example earlier, you know, how are they doing this so that it's secure? I mean, is it really just the front end is secure and that's the public part of it, and then everything gets funneled internally?
I would argue that you should have your Nginx server on your machine. Mm-hmm. And then that way the request receives it to the machine. And then once it's on the machine, then it doesn't escape it. And so there's your firewall at that point.
I see. Okay. So you're actually deploying it on the Nginx node itself. All right. So it's not.
You could do that.
All right.
Yeah. You could do that, or you could have it inside, but at least by that, like if you had a network of plumbers, then like separate instances, machines, then you could have your Nginx in front, but that would be your firewall, like cut off. Like, so it's the only way to reach the plumber instance to go through that Nginx.
And I'm getting ahead of myself. Like I'm not even remotely there, but I'm just curious about the long-term architecture, and is this the right tool? Yeah, thank you, Barret, this is amazing. Thank you very much. Silence. Somebody has got to have another question.
I'm just curious, can you tell us a little bit more about like applications you've seen like in the wild using Plumber? Like that's kind of the most riveting part to me is like you mentioned T-Mobile. I want to hear more. I want to know like what's worked for them, what hasn't worked for them? Like, you know, I'm sure maybe you can make functions that are too small to be useful in Plumber. Maybe you can make like, you know, too many routes that like that's bad practice, or like maybe there's certain like horror stories that you can tell us. I don't know.
There's not too many because it's like, you know, NDAs of clients, and so it's, it makes it hard. Yes, the T-Mobile is like a wonderful use case because they put that out publicly. So you can find their blog posts and, you know, what they went through and how they scaled and, you know, the pitfalls they ran into. I think it was, you know, it's really neat because they did ask for forgiveness, not permission. So they said, oh, you want an API? Yeah, we'll give you an API. And that's all they said. And they didn't tell them, oh, by the way, it's running R underneath the hood. Like that would have thrown up red flags to all the, you know, people above. But they just said, here's your API and it's fast. See, ta-da. And they had it benchmarked and they had, you know, they have made a load test package to load test the Plumber API, and it, you know, survived. So I thought that was really neat to see, like really neat to like prove that in production, like under load with live user input, it's working. And that was awesome. There's, you know, on the flip side, there's a wonderful like thought exercise of API design. Like what, you know, when you're making an R package, you want to be very careful about what you expose. You can change the underneath functions, no problem. But what if like ggplot changed its API tomorrow and all of the parameters wouldn't work? They, you know, they have to have the number one afterwards. Maybe you have to say ggplot 3 at the beginning to make it work. Like that would make people upset. So it's kind of fun to say like, what do you want in your API and can you support it forever? And if you can't support it forever, then what do you do? How do you fail to the next one so that you can still at least give some plausible feedback back to the users? And some people just say like, whatever, not my problem. And they gut it, which is great. That's a solution. It's really nice to do that if you can afford it. But if you start to get more in production cases, you know, how do you evolve while still handling legacy information? There's another exercise that I've wanted to do in a workshop where, let's say I have 100,000 records and you're trying to, and these records update, you know, every 10 seconds. So it's a non-trivial amount of records. How do they, and the order kind of shuffles. So you can think like Google results. So how do you page your results? Because I can't return 100,000 records of information to you in one shot. So I'll give you the first 10. So then how do you keep track of like, I want all the records up to 10 and then 10 more. And then, you know, what's my next one? And then, so there's like all this other information where you can like make your API very robust. The flip side, you can punt and say, we're just going to use GraphQL, and then you only expose one route, and your GraphQL schema can update, but that's like a whole nother talk. but it is another option to help support moving from, you know, evolving your API information.
I have to say, I find this stuff so exciting because I feel like it takes, you know, what could be in many teams like weeks or months to go from the code works on like one person's laptop, one, you know, analyst's or scientist's laptop, and, you know, to being somehow made like production available, even if that's just to test internally, which I think is like the most important point to kind of get to. But, you know, this seems like it shortens that to like, just a click of like deploying to Docker or something, or deploying to DigitalOcean or whatever, right? And then what I like about it is that it seems like you set yourself up to have more time to give developers or whoever you want time to kind of battle test your API, right? So whatever is behind it, you know, whatever your concerns are, if it's like privacy concerns or accuracy concerns of like the model or anything like that, you now have like, you've bought that back those weeks or months to say like, okay, the security team or whoever you want can like try to extract data that they shouldn't be able to from the model, or like to test that it's working really well in like lots of edge cases. And that seems like one of the places where people are always getting hung up. They didn't test their models thoroughly enough. They leaked sensitive data that they shouldn't have because they just didn't test all their API routes well enough, or they, you know, missed some security concern. So I love the aspect where it feels like you're buying back some time.
Yes. Like another example of that is, what if we, you built up your model over 3 months and then you made your shiny application so that your supervisor or your supervisor can approve it. And like you get your model done and that shiny application kind of just ends. Like that's the end of it. That's the story closed. Well, now we can deploy Plumber, or actually have Plumber be the backend for your shiny application. And so you can have Shiny share the same data that your API is, because it's just calling the API underneath the hood. And then that API can now be extended out, so that story doesn't end. So exactly as you said, to buy back more time. But I just think it's so neat to be able to like not have that stop at a Shiny application, because Shiny is only good for humans to click through. So a lot of today is being machine to machine communication. Cool. Well, I believe next week we're going to go through how to scale within your server, how to have Plumber scale within your server. So because I'm imagining we could say having model calculations take a couple minutes. You don't want your echo route to wait 2 minutes to respond. So I'm going to show how we can find out which routes are being slow, and then how to tell Plumber to say, hey, we should make this work on a different core, and then leverage all your cores. Because it's kind of fun when you have Gwen had a, what was it, like 128 cores and 256 gigs meg and memory or something like this.
Yeah, that was when I was doing, it was a couple years ago. It was when I was in transportation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And if you use R in its standard usage, you get one core and you get some gigs. So you're not even, letting the engine run. So
yeah, that was when I realized that Tidyverse is really slow. that was a bit of a shock to me. I thought it was like this great new thing, and I was like, no, if you go into base R and just vectorize, it's so much faster. And that really shocked me. So I got to give a couple talks on that. That was something that shocked me, but
So we'll go through that next week. I think it's a lot of fun. I have some good animations for you. I think it'll be exciting. So yeah, come join next week.
Thank you so much, Barret.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Well, thanks for having me. Much. Appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. You're like our first real talk, Barret. So I just want you to know.
Fun.
Thanks, Gwen. Thanks, Christian. Thanks, Nicole. This is amazing. Look forward to next
Bye,
week.
Bye, Todd. Thank you for coming. We appreciate you being here.
Thank you.
See you.
Bye, Faith.